Hi, welcome back to the channel. My name is Bob, and today we're going to take a look at the player secrets in Icewind Dale: Rime of the Frostmaiden. We're going to talk about how you can implement these secrets into your game, how players would use them to fill out their backstory, and I'm also going to invite my players from my live group to come in and talk about the player secret that they received during our session zero. If you'd like to take a look at our session zero, I will leave a link in the description below. If you'd like to subscribe to the channel and catch our live plays every week on Tuesdays, you can hit the bell icon for updates for when we go live with a new video. All right, so let's dive right in. Here I have the Roll20 module for Icewind Dale. Secrets are located in the Icewind Dale Adventure module on pages 264 and 265. But the DM resources for those secrets are actually on pages 14 and 15, which are located in the character creation section of the first chapter. The purposes of these secrets is to sow doubt and mistrust amongst the group. Some of the secrets aren't so malicious. They're more flavor or give background ideas for your player characters. Let's take a look at the player options and go through each secret individually and how they could be implemented in your game. Alagondar Scion. Basically, you are a part of the bloodline of Neverwinter. And if the heir, or the regent, I should say, to Neverwinter found out that you were alive, he most definitely would send a bounty hunter to kill you. Next, we have the doppelganger secret. I really love this secret. I thought that this was probably one of the coolest looking player secrets out there. It says, I'm a shape changer. I have none of the traits of my race I'm imitating, but I retain my class features, background, and alignment. I have dark vision out to the range of 60 feet, and I can use an action at will to do either of the following. I can innately cast detect thoughts, requiring no components. My spellcasting ability is intelligence. The spell's wisdom save DC is 8, plus my proficiency bonus and intelligence modifier. So a free detect thoughts spell. I can also polymorph into any humanoid I have seen or back into my true form. My statistics, other than my size, don't change, and any equipment I'm wearing or carrying isn't transformed. I revert to my true form when I die. There are so many useful possibilities for this. There's so many instances where you could mimic or, imitate a really important person, maybe a speaker in the towns, the 10 towns. Limitless possibilities for this trait. Now let's go take a look at the Drizzt Fan. This is the one trait that I think gets the least amount of love online. Basically, you just have a piece of Drizzt, the legendary drow elf's cloak. It's really no more than a flavor secret. I could understand why people would avoid this from their game, and I also avoided using it. But if you have a Drizzt fan in your party, this might be something to give them directly, or maybe give this to them along with another secret. The elusive paramour is next. A wealthy pasha in Kalimshan has placed a bounty on my head for seducing his favorite concubine. Bounty hunters are scouring the Sword Coast in search of me, but I hope they'll never think to look in Icewind Dale. Similar to the Alagondar Scion, there's someone who's going to be coming after you, and really it's up to the DM to decide who that assassin will be and when to put them into the game. The Escaped Prisoner. I was brought here from another world by space-faring mind flayers. The ship in which I was imprisoned crashed in the mountains south of Ten Towns. After surviving the crash, I nearly froze to death crossing the tundra to reach Ten Towns. If some friendly trappers hadn't found me, I would have perished. I fear some of my captors also survived the crash and might come looking for me. This secret has a lot of opportunity for story and deception. I think that the player character would want to avoid going to the crash site. In contrast, the player may also want to go back to this crash site, despite what it says here. They may actually want to go and investigate what happened to them. We have the Littlest Yeti next. I was raised by a Yeti. Although I relied on my ferocious guardians for food and warmth, I never quite adapted to the cold. I speak Yeti and have advantage on charisma checks made to influence Yeti or improve their attitudes. So this is basically a souped-up handle animal check when it comes to Yetis. I'm not too keen on this one. I think it's a little lame compared to the rest of the secrets. I guess you could add to it, but ultimately it falls a little flat for me. The Midwinter Child is next. Oriel the Frostmaiden has blessed me, for I was born on the Midwinter holiday. I have resistance to cold damage. While I think that this is a useful ability, I don't think it falls into the spirit of the survival element of this adventure. This is basically like having a feat. Next, we have the Old Flame. I have a lover in Ten Towns whom I haven't seen in years. At any time outside of combat, I can decide who that lover is by choosing an NPC in Ten Towns that I can see. Once I make this choice, I can't change it. The Old Flame is friendly and helpful toward me, even if our past is checkered. This is one of the only times I've really seen a player be allowed to change an NPC's favorability towards them without any rolls, and forcing the DM to adapt on the fly. Very interesting trait. The Orc Stone. They saved the life of an orc who gave me a stone with the symbol of Many Arrows tribe, a humanoid skull placed pierced by 3 arrows carved into it. The stone is an uncommon magic item and requires attunement, and only I can attune to it. As an action, I can use the stone to summon the spirit of an orc warrior, which appears within 30 feet of me. The spirit uses the orc war chief stat block in the monster manual and disappears after 10 minutes, or when reduced to 0 hit points. The spirit understands any language I speak and obeys my commands. After the stone is used 3 times, it turns to dust. The orc war chief is pretty powerful. So in low levels, this could be very useful. I think that once you use it, though, there should be some tie-in story-wise. Perhaps your character will meet that orc that gave it to you again, or perhaps a orc from the same clan or tribe. That way, it's not just a useful combat ability. The Owlbear Whisperer. Similar to the Yeti, this is a souped-up handle animal check. Owlbears are predisposed to like me. If I'm within 10 feet of an owlbear, I can use an action to make a DC 10 charisma animal handling check. On a success, I change the owlbear's attitude toward me from hostile to indifferent or indifferent to friendly. I'm not so keen on either of the animal handling secrets, but I think if you wanted to tie this in, it would be good for a ranger or a druid class that already uses handle animal. That way that DC 10 check can be made very easily. The Pirate Cannibal. One of my favorites from the list. I served aboard the Dark Duchess, a pirate ship from the city of Luskan. After the vessel got stuck in the ice, everyone but the captain abandoned the vessel and fled to Ten Towns. We got lost in a blizzard along the way. I was only one who made it, and only by eating my mates. The ship and its treasure are still out there, and so is that captain whose body is on the ship. This is a great secret to develop a backstory. I think that any character who would be a sailor or even a soldier, one of those types of backgrounds, would benefit from this one. So you can kind of decide when this happens. That could fit into any backstory, so long as there's enough time that they could have, you know, gotten back to the Ten Towns. The Ragged Heir. This has a prerequisite of being human, or at least half-elf or half-orc. I am an offspring of Queen Bjornhild Slovig's daughter, leader of the Tiger Tribe. My mother cast me into the Sea of Moving Ice when I was a young child as a sacrifice to Oryl the Frost Maiden. A polar bear pulled me from the water and spared me a freezing death. This bear then transformed into a Goliath, who bore me safely to the Ten Towns. I remember the Goliath's name, Oyaminartok. I don't know how to pronounce it, but I haven't seen her since. I owe her my life, just as I owe my mother a merciless death. A little bit of a revenge plot here. This one has some possibilities, but you have to have a human. Reincarnation. I died and was brought back to life by a friendly human druid using the reincarnate spell. I have no idea what became of the druid, whose name I don't know. I retained the memories of my previous life, some or all of which was spent in Icewind Dale. Roll on the table in the spell's description to determine your character's previous race, or choose the race from the table that you like. Then flesh out the story of your previous life. This one is slightly off theme. I don't necessarily know that it's good or bad. It just doesn't really tie too much into the whole Frost Maiden story. Ring Hunter. One of my least favorite, to be honest. I'm looking for a knucklehead trout that bit off my father's finger, which had a signet ring on it. To preserve my inheritance, I must retrieve this lost ring. This almost seems like a fetch quest. It doesn't seem like it's warranting a player secret or a background. The idea that you could even fish for knucklehead trout and have a 1% chance to find it almost seems too good. I think if a knucklehead trout actually ate a finger, that knucklehead trout would never be found again. Runaway author. I penned a notorious expose called The Hellbent Highborn, which accused several prominent patriarchs in Baldur's Gate and nobles in Waterdeep of being devil worshippers. Nice tie into the Descent into Avernus campaign. Although my accusations were well-founded, I made a lot of enemies and was forced to seek refuge in Icewind Dale. One of the things that Icewind Dale does best is play into the character background of the runaway, the outcast, and if you have a character who is trying to hide from their past, this is a perfect background for them. In my opinion, the Slod Host is one of the most strange secrets that a player could receive. A red slod implanted a pellet-sized egg in me shortly after I started my adventuring career. If I can't get rid of it in the next 2 months, the egg will gestate inside me and the slod tadpole will burst from my chest, alien style, killing me. It will then quickly grow into an adult slod and kill even more people. This one is a weird one. I think that there is a ticking time bomb element to this, which does lead to a lot of interesting character decisions and motivations. But if they can't cure this disease, the player is going to die. There's no real rules for what happens when this thing bursts from your chest. So you're going to have to decide whether or not you want this to be a death sentence to one of the characters. And if your characters are going to play this game for more than 2 months in game time, yeah, this may be something they have to come to terms with very soon. Final secret is that of the spy. Character is a spy for the Harpers, or a secretive organization that works behind the scenes to thwart tyrants and other evildoers. My mission on Icewind Dale is to safeguard the settlements of the Ten Towns while concealing my Harper affiliation. Credible threats to the Ten Towns include the Arcane Brotherhood, an organization of wizards based in Luskan, and the Zentarum, an expansive shadow network that wants to control trade throughout the north. Both have threatened Ten Towns in the past. My only Harper contact in Ten Towns is a human named Beldora, who poses as a homeless woman and spends her days gathering information in Bryn Shander. I find this a little lackluster. It's really not that special. It just seems to be one of those generic Forgotten Realms tie-ins to the organizations. First things first, I like a few of these secrets more than the others. So what I would do is I would suggest that you take out the ones that you don't want. Ones that you know you're not going to have fun running as a dungeon master, because if you're not going to have fun running them, even if it's a decent player option, you will have no motivation to incorporate it into the game. It will feel like a chore. The ones that I decided to get rid of were the Drizzt Fan. I also got rid of the Littlest Yeti. This was one of the animal handling secrets. We don't need two, and to be honest, I like the Owlbear one a little bit better. I think it's more plausible. I also eliminated the Midwinter Child. I don't necessarily think this is a bad one. I just did not want to give a player character free resistance to cold damage. It does have a tie into the story, yes. But again, I think the part of the scariness here is that the cold is dangerous and the monsters are dangerous that live in the cold. Also, if a character does have resistance to cold damage already, this is a useless feat. The Regged Air is one that I decided to leave out, although I would have contemplated bringing it back in if a character wanted to be a barbarian. Unless the character wants to be a race that lives on the plains in Icewind Dale, you really can't use this one anyway. And finally, the last secret that I did not use was Ring Hunter. I think this is probably right up there with the Drizzt Fan in terms of the least amount of payoff for a character. Even if they win that inheritance back, it's basically just a dead end. So with these 5 secrets eliminated, that left me with 12 secrets in total. I had my player characters roll a d10. I had my player characters roll a d12. And select one at random. I gave them the option of exchanging the secret they received in place of another, but they had to take the next one no matter what. So a lot of them did not decide to take it. You can be a little more lenient with this. You can decide to give them 2 or even 3 options and let them choose. It really all depends on how many secrets you have to dole out. If you only have 4 players, you could give each of them 3 of these secrets. If you have more than 4 players, you'll have to start limiting how many you deal. Alternatively, you could also select these secrets for the player characters. In a session 0 where people make characters, you could then decide which ones fit their character backgrounds best. This is also a great option because you can customize your secrets to the story. I do like having an element of randomness, of chance in the games, and I think players do have a fun time rolling, so I went with the standard method. In our session 0, my characters chose these 4 traits: Reincarnation, Old Flame, Elusive Paramour, and Pirate Cannibal. I've invited all of my 4 players to come and chat with me about their characters, their backgrounds, and how these secrets fit in. Let's welcome my first player, CJ. Okay, so I'm here with one of my players, CJ, who is playing a half-elf rogue. CJ, why don't you tell us a little about your character?
Okay, well, the character I'm going to be playing is his name is Edmund Brycine, created originally as a very folk hero, Robin Hood type character from the Shrek movies, kind of.
I thought you were talking about more like Robin Hood, the classical sense of Robin Hood. He's more of like a parody of Robin Hood.
A little bit of a parody of Robin Hood in that way. He's very jovial, very like proud of who he is, and is always trying to spread the message of who he and his great deeds are. It's kind of a theme that I have with a lot of characters that I've played in the past, is that eventually they all try and spreading their word, the word about like how great they are. Because they want their story to be told like the great adventures of back in the day, you know, like everyone knows of Elminster and
Digby,
Mordenkainen
Tensor, yeah.
and Tensor and like those are all wizards, and like there's also like fighters, Durnan, I think, from the Yawning Portal, characters like that, great fighters that.
Robillard from Greyhawk. Yeah, I know. Yeah, the great fighters. They're, but you're right, the rogues kind of stay a little bit more under the radar.
Yeah, but he really wants his story to be told. He really wants to be a great hero. He always says his name and that he is a friend of both elf and man because of his dual heritage. He kind of like wants to toe the line between elf and human
Yeah.
kind.
Now, when it comes to the character secrets, which everyone got one last night, your character had a very interesting secret, I think, that ties in pretty well to your backstory of trying to be this folk hero, and that is the old flame. I'm going to bring it up here on Roll 20 so people can see it. So, when you got this, what was your first reaction?
My first reaction was, this is going to be a lot of fun. The idea of just kind of being able to make a character friendly towards me, it's almost like a free charm person, which can be very powerful. And that it can be anyone, any NPC in 10 towns. And we were going over some of the leaders in 10 towns, and when there was one that was like a half ogre or the one that was a bully, I'm thinking, maybe that person is my lover. And that person now all of a sudden can't be as big of a bully, or maybe they can't do kind of something very bad to the party because were lovers.
You know, I didn't necessarily even think of who it could be per se, but because there's so many options, you're going to be so, meet so many NPCs, but picking a leader, you know, or somebody that could potentially be a villain could be really interesting, because then I have to pivot and decide exactly how this character would treat you almost on the spot.
Yes.
So it's
And
a little bit more, I have to do a little more work here.
that was also one of my thoughts, that this is a very dangerous backstory for you as a DM, because now all of a sudden I can just pick anyone as long as we're not fighting them and be like, that person, they're
Now the trick I think to this one is not picking too quickly.
Yes,
Right?
I think
Don't
that's
just
true.
jump to a conclusion and think that that is the person that you should pick. Maybe kind of feel it out a little bit. Do you think there's a time frame that we should pick it in though? Like you should you get to see who the person is first and then tell me
I
what
think.
could you wait till another encounter with them? Or I don't know, what do you think about that?
See, that's another interesting thing about this. It doesn't say I have to have a time frame. I mean, if you
Right.
want to impose one, that's fine, but the idea of like having several encounters with this person and making them less friendly to the party, and then all of a sudden revealing that, oh wait, she's my lover, suddenly turning around and being like, no,
I
doesn't
feel
do.
like I would allow you to have at least one full interaction with a person before you pull this card.
Okay.
But I'd say that after the second time, perhaps you would need to say something, because it would, I don't know, I do envision in like a movie or you know, in a book, there would be some sort of like comment right off the bat, like, well, look who it is, you know, something acknowledging.
Yeah, I think the don't do it immediately thing is good, because there's always that like those scenes in movies where like the the two characters are fighting, and like they almost fight the whole movie until that final scene where they do the flashback to where they were like best friends when they were kids. And it's like, oh, that's why he was fighting so hard to get her, because he was hoping to redeem. It's almost like a redemption story if they're really evil.
And maybe even if you're thinking about someone, let me know earlier on. I could even guide you towards, you know, oh, this would be a very good person, you know, something like that. If you're unsure, if you're like, oh, this person seems great, but I don't want to waste it on them if it's a one-time NPC. Or maybe it'd be fun to bring a one-time NPC that everybody loves back into the game. So if you're thinking about anything, I don't mind giving you a little bit of a sneak peek into like what I have in store, if it'll make the story that much better.
Okay. Yeah. That sounds like a great,
Or you could totally surprise me and make me change all my plans. It'd be fine.
All right. Well, I like to keep the DM on their toes. So
yeah,
I'm excited to see, because some people were very happy with their secrets. So it'll be interesting to see when they're revealed.
So I want to thank you again, CJ, for coming on and talking with me. We'll bring on our next player character. Thank you.
Great. Thanks a lot.
All right, everybody. I'm back with my next player, Joey. He was playing a white dragonborn paladin. Joey, why don't you tell us a little bit about the backstory of your character?
The name is Dot. D-O-G-T. Basically, he got on board the Dark Duchess as to be hired for, as like protection, and the ship ended up getting stuck in some ice. He had to like eat some of his crewmates, and then he finds himself in Icewind Dale.
Yeah, so actually your background tied in directly to the character secret, which was interesting, because at the beginning of our session zero, when everyone was discussing a way to get the group together, I think everyone was on board with the idea that you were all outcasts traveling to Icewind Dale. The only one who would be from Icewind Dale was, or at least not in that initial caravan, was Andrew, because he was a Icewind Dale native who was in the mountains and happened to rescue you and lead you back to town. Then we drew our secrets. So why don't we talk about the secret that you got, the pirate cannibal? I'm going to pull it up.
Cannibal. So yes. Not going to lie, when I rolled for my stats, I was pretty much set on being a paladin, given the high charisma and strength score. And then getting pirate cannibal is an interesting paladin choice. I thought the minus one constitution was going to be the only like weird paladin conflict, but no, pirate cannibal is also what I am. So the reason why my character is like a big tough paladin, but with like a minus one constitution, is that he like suffered severe hypothermia and famine after like trying to get off of his shipwreck.
Okay, so let's jump over to the secret here. So this is one of the character secrets that I really liked. I had a kind of like a top four or five of things that I would say were my favorites. How did this change the backstory?
So I was thinking, since this is my like secret, this is my backstory, so to speak, I probably shouldn't be with the caravan at the beginning. Hmm. I'm thinking my character like just got back from whatever this was, and that's how he meets up with the rest of the group, and he's just exhausted from the elements.
Right, so you basically almost died. This is basically a near-death experience that once you get to town, you know, it's taken its toll on you. You're permanently weaker because of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, and one quick question then. So how early do you want to have arrived before the session starts? Like, is this literally you're walking into town on day one, session one, or is it like you've been there for a day or two already?
So I'm thinking on session one, I'm walking into town.
So do you think Dot would want to go back to the Dark Duchess?
Probably not, given that he like ate people. But I'm thinking we rolled for our trinkets, and I got like an angry looking doll.
Yes, I remember
I'm
that.
Thinking that doll was probably one of the children of like maybe like a merchant on board who had died early.
Sure.
I'm guessing I don't eat the child, but I definitely eat like the other adults.
Yeah, well, or the kid wasn't necessarily on the ship. It was it was a keepsake from his daughter or son or whoever it was.
I mean, how long was I out there for? Like a
You
month?
could have been out there for a week or more. Yeah. It could take a long time going in the snow. So with a blizzard as well, it slows you down, you get lost. Yeah, I think that you could have had to eat them. It could have been weeks before you got back to the towns.
Yeah, I'm thinking it was like
So,
a couple weeks.
yeah. Okay,
Yeah, I'm thinking
okay.
I ate like maybe like two or three people.
Yeah. Maybe more. Who knows?
I don't know about more.
The
Also,
good thing
being a
about all these.
dragonborn, I was probably like, is this really cannibalism?
I bet you the people who were on board thought you were going to do that before they even knew who you were. So.
Maybe that was like the extra sting, is that
Yeah.
people on board were like, oh, he's gonna eat us. I'm like, no, I'm not. And then I got you.
Guys, I swear I'm not going to eat you. All right, well, I'm pleased with this secret. I hope you are too.
Oh, 100%.
All right, awesome. So I'm going to we're going to sign off and we're going to bring in the next guest to talk about their secret.
All right,
All right,
cool.
thanks, Joe.
Peace.
Okay, so we are back with our third player, Stefano. Stefano, welcome.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, good, good. So we've been talking about all the secrets, our character secrets with the party. Why don't you start off with telling us a little bit about your character's background?
I decided that my birth name is going to be Fladrian Eris, and that's where I got the alias Flare. And I went with the name Flare because it is a kind of a one syllable name that pops. And I've decided that my character is a famous musician, almost like a rock star, or as I mentioned in the session zero, like a Franz Liszt in the classical period. And I was rolling on Xanathar's guide to figure out kind of my life.
Oh, you did
And
what CJ was talking about in the
I
session
did
zero?
a charlatan list. I rolled something that I thought fit very well with my character, and it says that I learned at an early age that people are gullible and easy to exploit. So I kind of used that along with my, charismatic speaking ability to gain fame and people who loved me, and my parents kind of didn't want me to go into that route. But I was more about gaining the love of people.
This may be different. Sounds like you're really going here, you not necessarily to make more fame and everything. You're actually going to hide away, right? Is that what?
Yes.
So tell
Yes.
me your secret, and I'm going to bring it up on Roll 20 right now. Was the
Elusive paramour.
yes, exactly, elusive paramour. So does fit into the hideaway section of the charlatan. You need to escape. You need to get somewhere that you can lay where you can lay low. Why? So, did this change your thought on your backstory when you were in session zero?
It did change it just a little, because it gave me essentially my reason for running away. Whereas originally I thought that my reason would be that I was plagiarizing and stealing other people's lyrics, and I got found out.
Gotcha.
So in this case, I think that the lavish lifestyle and the love and the fame caught up to me, and I suppose I must have been playing some sort of concert in Kalimshan, and then this woman came up to me, and I decided to.
So
So,
yeah, not so much the plagiarism route.
yes,
Okay, great.
yes.
Okay, yeah. And your fame, we mentioned something about money. So your character does have money, right?
Yes, because I was incredibly famous and I had fans all over the place. Yes.
Right, but in Icewind Dale, I guess you couldn't take all of the gold with you, and what gold you had, you spent. Is that what we were saying?
Yes, I decided that I wanted to continue my lavish style of living, and over that month I overspent,
Okay.
and now I am running out, and it seems that I haven't learned very much. yet.
Good, good. There's room to grow as a character. I like that.
Yeah.
And do you think that your character would be paranoid, or is he just too confident to be like looking over his shoulder all the time?
I'm wondering if maybe I knew that this place would be safe.
You believe it is, yes.
So I don't think I'm paranoid okay. as much as I might start kind of like grumpy.
Okay.
That I have to be here.
Yeah.
Because
true.
this is not the place I envision myself. So yeah, I think it's an interesting place to start for mm-hmm. Flair.
Yeah.
And again, I'll see if he continues to have the chip on his shoulder as we go through, or if he, as you said, grows throughout and kind of becomes less about himself.
That's it. I think we're going to go to our last character next, which was Andrew's character. I'm excited to see what he thought about his secret. All right, Stefano, thank you again for coming on.
All right, thanks. I'll see you.
All right, everybody. Now I've got my last player, Andrew, who's here to tell us about his character. Andrew, what's your character's backstory?
I've been doing on the Xanathar's Guide, I've been doing the This Is Your Life thing, which was recommended by CJ. I was kind of a bit, I didn't thought I'll try, as CJ said, I didn't think it would be that cool. But I thought I would do it just for fun, and if it didn't come up well, I wouldn't do it. But it actually came up in a really cool way, kind of what I was thinking, but I think it'll leave a little bit better. So I auto-generated my character's name, and he came up with the name Everard, which kind of fits into him, kind of a low charisma kind of guy, because he calls himself Everard the Everhard.
Gotcha,
I don't know
so.
If maybe British slang, but hard in English is like strong, you know, tough. He knows his mother and father, and they're both alive. He actually has 5 siblings. And his mothers are still in, is it Targast? The name of the place here is. Mother
yes.
and father are still in Targast, but his mother's known throughout Targast for being not like debilitatingly mad, but just kind of the amusingly, slightly crazy woman. Everyone likes her, but she's just known.
Okay, so she does have like a reputation within Targos.
Definitely a reputation.
Okay, so that's good. I'm glad I'll get an opportunity to NPC her at some point, I'm sure.
That would be bad for Everard. He would be embarrassed. Yeah.
So let's talk about your secret, Reincarnate. Reincarnate spell is linked here on Roll20, but ultimately there's a chart here that I don't think I showed you, but this is really all optional because you could just make stuff up. If you would prefer, you can create your story. But, you know, things like getting killed in an avalanche, being pulled into the lake by a knucklehead trout, and drowning. These are all 10 towns ways that you died. And then you have the reincarnate spell, which basically just describes this process where the spell creates a body for you to enter if your soul is willing. And basically you go into the new body that was created, and the body that gets magically, that magically appears takes the form of a creature, and it gives you a D100 to roll on, and it's, you know, all the starting races, basically.
And he had a famous relative in the militia, in the Ten Towns militia. So when kind of the orcs attacked, he decided to join in with the army. And he did pretty well in the army. He was a ranger. He blazed trails. He went scouting. This is where he got his kind of ranger skills. And he was in a lot of battles, and a lot of his friends got killed, but he was always unscathed until finally he had this terrible battle with the orcs, and all of his regiment, all the people who were there, they were all killed, and he was just on his own. In the winter, he went off to find these orcs, and he never came back. And basically, he did find them, and they killed him, like saying. And just as he came back, he saw this caravan being attacked by orcs, which he now hates, and he went and he helped them fight off the orcs, and now he's hanging out with his new friends.
Okay, so were you a human before you died, and then when you reincarnated back into a human body?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He just wouldn't let on. He would know that he looked different.
Yeah, and no, he would know, yeah.
I figure he's come back convinced that his destiny lies, almost to an irritating way, his destiny lies with these guys and he's come back with. And he's gonna be with them until the destiny is resolved. But he wouldn't want to let that on. He wouldn't want to let in that he was reincarnated.
Not to the group.
Right.
Oh, okay. So you're going to actually, you're basically starting over a new life then.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Okay, so your parents would have presumed you're dead?
Yep.
Oh, okay. This is actually quite
went
different.
Mad, ran off for the orcs, must have died in the cold, and their body never found.
It's like the movie Face Off, where you just become you have a new identity.
Right, exactly, completely new. Like, who's this stranger in town?
Wow, okay, interesting. A lot of things to think. Yeah, a lot of things to think about with this now. Mm-hmm. Okay, and will you still go by Everard then, or will you have an alias when you're in town, or do you have like a nickname that you'll tell the group?
I didn't think about that. I thought about calling myself Checkmate for some reason, but I don't know
that's not bad. Well, Everard could be your adopted name now, your new adopted name. But you can think about that more from now until we start on Tuesday. So nothing needs to be put in stone.
Yeah.
Well, I think we've covered the secret pretty well. What was your reaction when you got this secret?
Well, first of all, I had the whole backstory in my head, and I saw it, and I was like, oh, no, how is this going to fit in? But then I read that he could have already been from 10 towns previously.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I thought, oh, this is great.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, exactly. It's, yeah, I mean, you just died. You know, you came back, but yeah, you have all your memories. Nothing changes. I like this idea of this, like, you're an unknown in the town now. All right. Well, I think, like I said, I think we've covered this pretty well. I'm so excited for our first session on Tuesday. I've got lots of great ideas after talking with all the players. Andrew, thank you again for coming on and chatting with us about your secret.
No problem.
Alrighty, so everyone, on Tuesday, I believe that is October 6th, am I correct? Yes, Tuesday, October 6th at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time, we will be having our first live play session of Descent into Avernus. Oh, wow, look at that. I'm going to have to edit that one out. We're going to have our first live session of Icewind Dale, Rime of the Frost Maiden. All right, thank you, Andrew. One last thing before you go. This is a new D&D channel with live content every week. Our Icewind Dale group begins their journey on Tuesday, October 6th, with our first session. Be sure to like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon for notifications whenever we go live with a new video. I hope you enjoyed this content. I'll see you on the tabletop.